Welcome to a care collab for the lemon yellow orchid. Thank you, Orchids and Finboss, for joining me on this care collab. So much appreciated because I have blooms and I'm very proud of my blooms and my lemon yellow orchid, Renanthera citrina to be exact. Orchids and Finboss is in South Africa and will be joining me on this care collab, and I have his channel link in my description below for you to then hopefully go over and check out his Renanthera citrina. Very much appreciate the fact that you joined in on this, Orchids and Finboss. It is always nice to do a care collab together with someone, otherwise it wouldn't be a care collab. This is a lot more fun, and I do appreciate the fact that we can feature my blooms and then compare the two orchids as to how they are behaving in different hemispheres. Lemon yellow orchid, my goodness, I've been around the block now for the last 20 minutes trying to find the right place so that I can showcase the blooms. I'll show you at the end of the video what else I tried. Epic fail. That is why we're here, sort of like in a little camp out. Imagine a little fire pit, marshmallows. This will not be a horror story on a spooky night out in the woods, but a little bit about my Renanthera citrina. Once again, I'm going to try and do it the right way. Renanthera citrina. I do like the elegant sounding name of Renanthera. I just have as yet to engage my brain to pronounce it correctly. Anywho, I'm sat here on my patio in southern Spain, staring through the viewfinder at some gorgeous, gorgeous yellow blooms with red little dots on them that are absolutely not fragrant, but it doesn't seem to deter the ants from adventuring all along that spike. And the branches, as you can see, I have branches. We'll turn her around a little bit later on. So the only pest I can discover here that is really annoying me are ants. Oh well, but again, I'm on my patio in southern Spain, and this one does not belong here as such. It would much prefer to be in its native habitat of Vietnam, specifically in the northeastern province of Cao Bang, near Tra Linh and near Ha Giang. And I hope that I've done those names justice. It should not be growing in Lekka either. I have mine growing in Lekka and self-watering, and we'll get to that. It would prefer to be on weathered limestones, but limestones, schmimestones, Lekka stones, something rocky. So I thought, well, I don't have weathered limestone, I have Lekka, let's put her into Lekka. And it's also in self-watering because of my extremely dry climate here for most parts of the year. So when we speak of humidity and why I chose Lekka, not just because I don't have weathered limestone, is because my humidity here in winter will only go to 70% on average. And this orchid prefers to have a humidity of 70 as a minimum. And that is in her warmer months, her grow months of the year. I don't have that, hence Lekka and self-watering, because for my grow months of the year, my humidity drops to 30% on average, meaning it can go down to 10% without any problems for days on end. So I am compensating the humidity or the lack thereof with Lekka and self-watering. And she's been okay with that from day one. I've had no issues. The beauty of this orchid is that she can tolerate temperatures of single digits in Celsius, the lowest being 7 to 9 degrees is what she can handle during the winter. Which is fabulous because this year, for the first time, she's going to be staying outside. In the past years, I have been babying her because, as you can see, my little Renanthera citrina is a little bit wonky. And I needed her to get established in my Lekka and self-watering. See that the curve there? Yeah. And before I would expose her to that harsh elements of the outdoors in winter, I wanted to make sure that she is perfectly established, happy, growing. And this spike is magnificent, and it shows me that she is perfectly established and happily growing. Because in 2019, my first spike from her was about 4 blooms, maybe 5. 2020, I had maybe 7 or 8, not quite sure. But I've never had a spike of this length and magnitude and 2 branches as well. So proof in the pudding. And there's my little king there. proof in the pudding, she is doing really well. So for the first winter this year of 21, she is going to be able to live outside because she can tolerate the single digits. Now my winters can go down to 5 degrees Celsius, granted, but she is on the south shelf of my blooming alley, protected from the really, really harsh outdoors, closer to the building, not so much exposed, and 5 degrees Celsius is what I can get there, and I'm sure she will be absolutely fine. By which time, I will keep the lekker a little bit on the drier side. I won't be having the reservoir filled the way I do now, but just a bit drier. And the only reason I say a little bit drier is because there won't be any water in the reservoir. I will just be flushing her through just to maintain the wetness of the microfiber so that that doesn't dry out. But other than that, happy days. This one can graduate to outdoor living 24/7, 365 days a year, which is fabulous because as she is growing so much bigger and her roots are extending out a little bit too far, I'm trying to use the light training to get her to correct herself a little bit, not while the spike is growing, but eventually we'll get back to that light training. The way I position her on the shelf just to correct her growth habit a bit. And she's taking up a lot of space now on that little shelf in my dining room. So outdoors, happy days, this is gonna be a good one. The daily temperatures in winter in my climate are between 15 and 20 degrees Celsius, depending. And this one, hey-ho, can tolerate temperatures between 15 and 20 degrees Celsius. Perfect orchid, you could say cool to intermediate, it can be hot, but the only difference being, and the struggle I have, is humidity. If I want to call it a struggle, it is because my roots dry out. They don't extend themselves to the extent that they would like. So what I have to do on the daily, and here comes a little bit of, look, he is right there, he knows what's coming, it's almost like he is teasing me to do it. But in order to maintain the humidity, I spray my orchid down at least once a day to give those roots some humidity. Je m'excuse, King. Perdona. Yeah, so he just shook himself. Welcome to my little patio. Thank you for being here. So here we are. That's what I do every day, at least once a day in the morning with plain RO water. On a still day like this, I just do that once a day. On the really, really hot days, I may need to do that 2 to 3 times a day. So it is a high maintenance orchid when it comes to the weather being hot, dry, and windy. But other than that, it is a very, very easy grower for me. Where I have it located in my south facing blooming alley, it is getting a lot of bright light. Now this orchid in its habitat loves a lot of light, but only to the point of not burning the leaves. I almost missed the mark at one point, depending on the angle of the sun. My little blooming alley can get direct sun at certain times of the year. And when she comes out from the dining room, even though she's under artificial lights for the winter, sunlight is a different story. So yeah, we almost lost it there. But other than that, she is in bright, bright shade at the moment. Everything, all the walls reflect white. And then in the winter, this time, as the angle of the sun will go down, she will be getting direct sunlight depending on the angle of the sun, but that coincides with a drop in temperatures. So there are no problems at all with that. The angle of the sun, the time of year does the work for me. I won't have to worry. At least I say that with a little bit of trepidation because she's been doing so well with my indoor-outdoor regime that, you know, the first time an orchid stays outside all winter long, it's a little bit of eek moment, you know, you're just a little bit more cautious and wary, but I think she's going to be fine and we will visit her again at some point, especially if Orchid and Finbos has his blooming while we are in winter, then we'll have a look, see what mine is doing and how it's faring while it's outside. So I mentioned how my self-watering setup is helping me with regards to how I can take care of this orchid's needs during the summer. This is really, really fundamental for its well-being that it gets a lot of water. In my case, I have to give it a lot of water. Where it would live, it would be happy on a weathered limestone, absorbing all that humidity. I mean, up to 95% humidity. An orchid doesn't need watering if that much humidity in the air. But for me, self-watering comes into play because I just don't have the humidity that it would prefer to have. Now, I mentioned also about the winter, I'm keeping my Renanthera a little bit drier simply by flushing. And that is also because she's not really an active growth. She slows right down, comes to a grinding halt, I would say, in those temperatures. So I don't fertilize her at all during the winter. I just flush her through to maintain the wet microfiber. That is all. I don't want to lose the wicking capacity of my leca throughout the winter. But when I see a spike coming, that is when I will start to fertilize. And I start gradually at 160 parts per million. And then I fill the reservoir, maybe 2 centimeters, an inch or so, with that fertilized water. And when that's been absorbed, I will flush the pot through 2 times using the mask with plain RO water, and then fill again with 160 parts per million of fertilizer. She's holding onto this spike really, really well. In the last years, I've noticed that the blooms don't last anywhere between 3 to 4 weeks. And once the last buds open, the first blooms would drop. That is temperature based, in my opinion. We have had, I won't say cold May, the last 6 weeks. I won't say they were cold, but I'm still in a sweater at night. That is pretty cool for me for this time of year. And that is why also she has held onto her blooms so very long. The branching hasn't affected the first blooms that have opened, and I have 2 branches and there's 1 back here. Granted, they're not long, but it's her first time doing this. And her spike at the end has not finished opening all her buds, but her first blooms have not deteriorated either. And that to me is weather based. So depending on weather, between 3 to 6 weeks, yes, and I'm chasing an ant here. Between 3 to 6 weeks, I have these blooms gracing my blooming alley. They are absolutely not fragrant by no means, but my goodness, they are so gorgeous. The Renanthera monachica has a little bit more vibrancy and a little bit more oomph in the blooms, but these are much more delicate. Now the camera shows a creamy yellow. They are a little bit more bright yellow, but wherever I move her, the camera won't capture the proper yellow. Either it is reflecting off the wall or the sun is washing it out. So this is as best as I can do. Maybe some photography inserted will show the true colors. So this looks like a baby yellow, and she's a little bit more, has a richer yellow than that. So if you look at the lip here, for example, that is the color of the blooms. And the lip would be much more darker. Very, very beautiful, great features. So when the blooming has finished and she starts to kick into active growth based on the heat that is hopefully coming at some point, that is when I'm going to up the fertilizer to 300 parts per million. Same procedure, every time the reservoir is absorbed, flushing through twice with plain RO water, and then filling the reservoir with fertilized water once again. Apart from the ants that you saw, or ant, I don't know, but before filming, I did try and remove all the other ants. Apart from the ants, I have had no pest issues with this orchid whatsoever. And if I can repeat myself and you don't mind, I would definitely say she is an easy grower. I mean, I have not got the conditions that she likes when it comes to humidity, but I certainly have temperatures. But there has been no pest issues with her at all. I just want to show you why I'm so fussed about ants this season, because normally I like my ants on my orchids. They keep my happy sap in check. But if you start ruining my buds and blooms that I've been looking forward to for a whole year, it's war. No way. So this is ant damage before the bloom even could establish herself while they were messing around with the bud, which is a shame. And yes, I'm greedy like that. I want all my blooms. I don't want to have a selective thing of what ants seem to think is okay for them to open and leave alone, and which blooms I can enjoy. I want all the blooms. There's plenty of other vegetation around that can actually provide nutrition and fun and games. Jungle gym circumstances for ants. They don't need my blooms. Here we can now see the brighter yellow. as I turn this around and face her away. To the right of me is a black blanket. I'll show you just now. But if I were to film her the other way around, the white walls reflect off the yellow, but the black blanket to the right of me is actually blocking the light, giving me the opportunity to show you the proper yellow. I didn't start the video out in this angle because of all the other visual pollution in the background. Okay. Oh well, I hope you get my point. She is just so pretty. She is not as slow a grower as the Renanthera monachica. Not at all. She's a little bit more vigorous and faster. I find Renanthera monachica to be extremely slow, but this being a species and in the family, not a slow grower whatsoever, and a pleasure. She's not large. She won't take up a room very, very quickly. She's great for a bit windowsill with lots of bright light. I would encourage you, if you don't have a Renanthera citrina, and if you like yellows, and if you all these funky little polka dots and bell-bottom petals and sepals. There's a lot of nonsense going on in this bloom, but it is beautiful. Highly, highly recommended. Let me know if you have any questions if I haven't circled back. This is a very casual, like I said, sit around the campfire, I'll tell you about my Renanthera citrina stylee. Thank you so much to Orchids and Fynbos for your time and your video. I so look forward to seeing how yours is behaving, what temperatures you're keeping her under, all that good stuff. And thank you everybody very much for watching my video. Let's get up close one more time. Have yourselves a wonderful day, everybody. Please stay safe and take care. Bye.